Hi. Oh gosh, can't see anybody. It's so dark out there. Okay, I'm Karen O'Hara, and I'm presenting to you today effective patient engagement. So my presentation aims to give you some practical ideas and some tools to ensure that your advocacy efforts in your countries, that your campaigns are effective, structured, and targeted at achieving your desired results. So the content of my presentation is, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the Advocacy One Toolkit, which a lot of you have seen, about developing your objectives for your campaign, and also giving you some ideas to support and deliver your advocacy campaign once you've designed your objectives or developed them. So the first thing was the Advocacy One Toolkit. That was developed by Alpha One Global to help you develop your campaign and your activities in your countries. And I was asked to deliver the pilot training session in Norway, in Oslo. And the reason I was asked to do that was in my previous life, before Alpha One took over everything, I used to be a professional IT trainer. So it was a good thing for me to deliver the training session. But also, I was the UK lead for the campaign that we were having in our country at the time. So we held the pilot in November 2015 with the patient group representatives from Norway, Denmark, and Sweden. And they thought it was an excellent toolkit and found it very useful. So we then rolled it out further in Milan last spring. And that was to representatives from France, the Netherlands, Portugal, Germany, Romania, Austria, Poland, and Switzerland. And you can download the toolkit from the Alpha One Global website. It's available, obviously, in English, but also in French, German, Italian, Portuguese, Romanian, Spanish as well. So you can use that to help you. So what's in the toolkit? I'm not going to go into detail about it. You can download it and read it at your leisure. But essentially, it enables you to establish in detail your advocacy strategy and goals. So it'll give you some useful tips. It'll help you to understand the situation that you have and your audience. It'll give you the opportunity to perform a SWOT analysis. If you don't know what that is, it enables you to look at what your strengths are, what your weaknesses are, your opportunities and your threats. You'll also have information there, excuse me, to develop and communicate your advocacy message. So it's okay once you've written it, but you need to deliver it to the right people. And there's some sample letters there to help you once you've developed your campaign. So the first thing you need to do is develop your objectives. Your objectives have got to be smart. So smart, to help you remember it, smart, it needs to be specific. It needs to be measurable, attainable, realistic, and timely or tangible. So what does that mean? So if we look at specific, you need to state exactly what it is you want to achieve. And you need to be focused, clear, and unambiguous. So what is it you want to achieve? Why do you want to achieve it? Who is involved? Where you want it, perhaps? And any requirements or constraints? So it needs to be measurable. How much or how many? How will you know when it's completed? So if your objectives are measurable, you can track how you are doing with your campaign. You can also report progress to stakeholders and the patient community. And it lets you know if you need to change your efforts or your direction slightly. For example, if you said you wanted to increase your membership, it's not very measurable, but if you say, I want to increase my membership by 10%, it's much more measurable. You know when you've got there. So you also need to set objectives that are attainable. Attainable. Good. Okay. So be realistic. You need to set your objectives high, but not too high so that you can't reach them. And don't underestimate what you can achieve either. So don't set them too low. So for example, saying you wanted to have an Alpha 1 specialist in every single city in your country is probably not attainable. There aren't that many. So that wouldn't be an attainable objective to set. But saying you want to increase how many specialist centres you have in your country might be something that you could achieve. So, excuse me. So your objectives also should be relevant. So by relevant, aligned to your mission, they should be of benefit to the patient community. So irrelevant objectives could actually confuse your supporters and stakeholders. So try and be as relevant as you can. The last one is timely or tangible. So you might not actually be able to set a time scale for when you want to reach your objective. But if you make it tangible, you'll know when you've achieved it, because if it's tangible, you can taste it or touch it. You can feel it, see it, or hear it. So it reaches your senses. So what I've done here is I've given an objective. It's based around the UK objective. It isn't our exact objective, but it's based around it. So our objective here is to profile the unmet medical need of Alpha 1 patients and to campaign with ministers and healthcare officials for better services and care for Alpha 1. And your objective can also include subpoints. So you can drill down a little bit and be a little bit more specific. So better and more equal access to multidisciplinary clinical care, and also access to optimal treatments and rapid access to any forthcoming licensed medicines. So this objective is specific because it addresses what we want to achieve. We want to achieve better care and treatment. Who are we targeting? We're targeting the ministers and the healthcare officials. Why do we want to achieve it? Well, we've got an unmet medical need. It's measurable. We'll know when we get better care, and we'll certainly know when we get treatment. Relevant. It's relevant to the patient community. Patient community wants access to treatment, and they want and need better care. And it's timely and tangible, because we'll have a better healthcare experience and hopefully access to treatment. So because this objective is linked to a healthcare provision, you need to make sure that the clinicians are on the same page as you, because if you're not talking from the same page and being very clear and unified in what you're asking from your healthcare providers, you won't achieve it. So don't ask for something that the clinicians don't support. Work together. It's really important. And you can use the Advocacy One toolkit to help you develop your campaign objectives. And from the training, we picked out some things that patient organisations said they thought they could do better. So educate and raise awareness among physicians and paediatricians, creating a multidisciplinary network of Alpha 1 specialists, extending access to augmentation therapy, increasing detection through screening programs, or creating a registry. So that's just some ideas that have come from the patient community already. So some ideas to help you support. You've designed your objective, you know what it is you want to achieve, You've made sure it's smart. So what do you do now? So what some of the things that we did, and this is one of them, we realized we had an unmet medical need in the UK, and we designed an online survey, and we used it to produce two policy reports, and it really highlighted the unmet medical need that we had for alphas in the UK. And we contained very detailed results of the survey, and there were some policy recommendations to close the gaps in care, and it was all based on the patient's opinion. And we also included a foreword, which was given by politicians and leading Alpha 1 clinicians that supported our campaign. So some other ideas as well. Things that we've done or ideas that might help. So parliamentary seminars, we launched our policy report in Parliament, and we had a panel, and we had clinicians, leading healthcare, members of the healthcare services, so the NHS in our country. We had members of parliament, we had clinicians, and we invited a lot of people from all of those areas, so clinicians, politicians, to come along to the event and hear us talk about it. You can also maybe create flyers and have them included in delegate conference bags to reach the wider clinical community. You can write letters to parliament and politicians. We again used an online tool. We produced the letter. We left a blank space so that patients could put their own personal experience. And at the back end of the system, it targeted their local member of parliament. So we knew who had been contacted so that we could then follow up these parliamentarians, and we could contact them and say, are you coming to the meeting? What are you doing? And we got the patients to go and meet with these people as well. So you can have meetings with politicians in hospitals, and you can include your clinicians with that. You could create online petitions to support your cause, which you can then deliver to Parliament afterwards. You can meet with senior politicians, get the patients to do it as well. Engage in the formal processes aimed at improving clinical care. That's probably one of the most important things that you can do. You need to engage in the process. Engage with the health technology appraisal bodies as well to ensure that patient voice is heard. We know they want to hear from patients. It's important. Our voice is important. Utilise the materials or advocacy ideas that have been produced by either Alpha 1 Global or other Alpha patient organisations. You're here, speak to each other, find out what you're doing. You've also heard about the European recommendations that were launched in the European Parliament just last month, and the sections in here which will target information about Alpha 1, so it'll tell them about Alpha 1. Policymakers, there's a section targeted directly at them, what they can do to help you. Healthcare professionals, how they can improve your health, and individuals and carers, so patients as well. You heard from Sandra yesterday, again, her presentation, addressing the challenges to improve patient access to augmentation therapy. It's a problem for most of us. More patient and payer-focused strategies, cross-stakeholder collaboration, and patient experts. We're the experts. And we all have to work together to gain access to augmentation therapy or better care, if that's what we want to do. So in summary, I've got 55 seconds before Karen carries me off. Start with what you want to achieve. You need to know where you're going before you can start going there. If you're going on holiday, you'd choose a destination. Then you work out how to get there. Ensure your message is targeted and relevant to the audience. Understand and get actively involved in the political and administrative processes that shape Alpha 1 and care. And try and make sure that it's a win-win situation. A win for you, a win for the payers, and a win for the clinicians. If it's win-win, everybody likes it. Establish, maintain, and foster relationships with clinicians, campaign supporters, and relevant stakeholders on a local, regional, and national level. So thank you. I hope you found the conference enjoyable and empowering. And I think we all have to remember that we're in this together, and without the patients, industry can't do anything, and clinicians can't do anything, and we need both of them too. So let's do something together to achieve better care and access to therapy. Thank you.
I'm a human being, I'm moving, I need some space, and so I think the patients are not the scientific part of the story, but we are very special individuals. We have our own story, and it's a pleasure today to give you some ideas about what I think today, what is important. My name is Frank Willersen, I'm 63 years old. I'm ZZ treated in Belgium, and I think I'm very lucky. And I know about that, and when I see my colleague Gunhild Nordhave from Norway, who has no treatment, I think that is unfair. And this kind of unfairness, of discrimination, brings me up here today and quite nearly every day for a couple of years now. And I think it's important to do something and to share some ideas with you today about this. For a patient association, starting with one or two or three patients, as we have today, the situation in Romania or in Poland, of course, the most important thing is to get a message and to bring out a leaflet in a printed report to distribute something to other patients, to other doctors, to other stakeholders, to get an identity, with a color, with a logo. And here you have the example on the left side of the leaflet of our Alpha One Switzerland Association leaflet, which came out a couple of months ago. This association in its first year, starting quite well, and they are now 35 members. And the leaflet is distributed in Switzerland to the universities, to the lung doctors, and to other lung institutions. So get a printed report to start. And then, as Karen explained about our advocacy toolkit, it is very important to get the most important message, even if it's awareness to go for, or detection of patients, or access to care for alphas. But as a young patient association, you cannot do everything. There is a lot of work to do, and the advocacy toolkit, we can help, and we help, of course. We give some training, some education. We need to take the energy in the patient leadership, in the people, to empower them, because most of them, they would like to go through walls. We have a couple of very good examples here in the room. And there are different priorities in an association. Once it started, about how to find the people, how to find the patients, how to find people who would like to do something, how to find the pearls in a country or in an association, and what about funding, how to get run the work. Because, of course, without money, nothing can run in this kind of activity. So this is a slide I showed you 2 years ago. It's about connection from patients to other stakeholders and different levels of importance, which the people and the leadership should get in contact with. It makes sense here, of course, to come together. If, for example, the Romanian people meet the Swiss people, or to interconnect with the French Patient Association, that's very important, to see what is the situation, how it works, and what could be done. The European and the international level is the most difficult one, because all these umbrella structures are structures which are not easy to connect to, but we are all important, even as a small association. And as I told you 2 years ago, all these movement of contacts and events on a national, on an international level, gets to a network which is very powerful. For example, in Europe, we have, as most of you know, we have Orphanet. It's a registry about the orphan diseases. We have Eurodis with the summer school, which is a training school for patients of rare diseases. And we have the European Reference Network. COPD associations are very important because we find some alphas in there, and they have the same problems of treatment in a certain way. EUPATI is a European Patient Academy for Innovative Medicine, which is another umbrella structure. And then we have small groups like the Plasma User Group or IPOPI, which are the group of immune deficiency patients. We have it nearly in every country. Also like the European Hemophilia Consortium with hemophilia national groups. I think for alphas that's important to have some contact with them, what they do. In principle, they know how the national health system is running, and we can learn as an alpha association a lot from them. The European Lung Foundation, of course, will bring out the next guidelines, and they do a lot of research. We should get connected to them, and also the European Patient Forum, which is an umbrella structure in Brussels, is useful to know what they are doing and perhaps even to get in. To get into Orphanet is quite easy for a patient association like the Alpha One, and of course this is one of the first steps to get a known identity in the country. EUPATI as an umbrella academy now has a lot of national groups. And for example, in Romania, they are established in Bucharest. You should take some contact with them because they can help the alphas to get integrated more in the running of the daily life of the health system. We have to make friends, and we have friends. And more you open up, you will find friends. And sometimes you will find a pearl, and there are moments with gifts when you meet somebody, you didn't wait for it, and they open up and help to go further, not always to resolve a problem, but to find a way to have a different look and to go through. The European Reference Network is a new structure which will change the landscape of rare diseases. It's a European action. It was implemented about 4 weeks ago by the Commissioner of the European Health. And the European Reference Network has a lot of groups. So only there's one group called the European Reference Network Lung, which has this week this kickoff meeting in Frankfurt. So our professor Joanna Jorosowska-Winmenko is there with Jan Stolk and some patients from Italy. Dr. Korda is there also. They are not joining us here today and yesterday. And the story is that I got an email 3 days ago from Joanna, and she said in her mail, "Well, Frank, I'm so sorry, I'm so sad, I cannot be in Lisbon." And I said, "Joanna, we are networking. You are in Frankfurt. I would like to be in Frankfurt, but I'm in Lisbon." And so we work together, and we update each other, of course, what is going on in other moments, in other situations. But working together doesn't mean we have to do everything for everybody. No, we get supported by everybody around us. And for me, that's a very important message. Networking means to get supported what are around you and to get some help and not to distribute all what you have to everybody. So, of course, there is a background of the European Reference Network, which is implemented now and structured for 5 to 6 years. There are patient groups. You can have a look at the internet, and you should, as an Alpha 1 patient association in Europe, have a look at that, because when we see the complexity of this structure, which will be implemented on the national health system in whole Europe in a couple of days, in the ERN Lung Board from Professor Wagner, there is one small Alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency group, which the coordinator is Professor Stolk from Leiden. And there is also a patient advisory group in this strategy. But it will take some months, even some years, to concrete the data, the registries, the whole structure to keep it working. But this reference network will give some advice to all of the countries in Europe about our disease. So I think it's very important because, first of all, it's powerful, it's slow, and it will come up. And we should be aware about that. So here you can see, I was in Vilnius for the launching of the ERNs, and in the Alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency group, there is a patient group, and I was the only patient there, because, even nobody applied or nobody knew about that. And so I said, I would like to get in there. I'm here, so please put me in. As you know, I'm on the steering committee of Alpha 1 Global, to get connected and to bring the data over to you, to the association, to everybody about our disease. Then I had a look about the members of this European Reference Network, and as you see, there are some Alpha 1 association, some of us in there, but not very, very many. I mean, we are more than 15, and here you have about 5 or 6. So please have a look on the internet and get a member of this list, because it will help to all the work which is done in the European Reference Network to get you in and your advice and what would you like to know and to realize. And we need your help in there in the next years. The European Patient Forum is an institution about lobbying and also representing patients on a European level. You should know, have a look what they do, and perhaps even get a member in one or another day. There are also, for example, the European Federation of Allergy and Airway Disease Patient Association, which is also an APEDA structure in Europe. And they are in Brussels also, I think. And all not-for-profit association can get in there and be a member and have some news about things are going on all these levels. When I looked at Australia, and I don't know the situation at Australia, the question is, of course, what the alphas in Australia should go for and how to link. And of course, there is a structure of rare diseases called Rare Voices Australia, which is known. The other structures like the St. Vincent Hospital in Melbourne or the Meredith Children Research Institute. It depends on the situation, what is the situation of us, of the alphas in Australia, and where to find the help if they can go further with us, hand in hand. Because in the network working, as I told you, we have to go together, but it doesn't mean that we have more work. It means that we can get supported also. South America is very important. There are a lot of alphas in South America. As you know, we started to structure on the steering committee. We have a meeting this afternoon to get structured South America in a better way for the next 2 or 3 years. There are different umbrella structures in South America, which we are connected today. And this is to show you that even if we are here in this room today, there are so many things going out outside, and of course we have to connect, but also we have to choose and to get our priorities. United States is a special situation, of course. We have the foundation there, but also AlphaNet and different structures. All these landscapes are moving, and things are coming up, and other things are going under. And on the steering committee in Alpha One Global, we are quite aware about these changes every week or even every day. And when we try to keep an equilibrium to get the best or to get our priorities, because everything should be done, but we have to choose. And I think even we should do a little less and not to try to do everything on my to-do list, but to select and sometimes to say, this is not for today and not for me, and to take off. For me, it's important to say to the patients, and this is a patient congress, get into trials. Because I think trials are very important for research and also to get connected to doctors, to researchers, to data. Patients should be open to help, and they will. I met two patients in the last 2 years who said, I don't want to get into a trial anymore. They got their experience. They thought both the treatment was so inhuman, so they stopped it. I think that's completely okay. And there will be other trials for Alpha One coming up. Not also on inhalation aerosol, but also with classical products or with new products in the next year. There will be trials, and the patient can find on the internet which trials are going on. In Alpha One today, as I know, there are more than 100 studies, clinical trials going on today, which are open or closed. Or, of course, you have criteria to get in. But we should be aware about that, because it will help to bring the future. And I thought yesterday about this discussion. if a patient would like to accept new therapy, like aerosol inhalation. And I thought about that, what was happening yesterday, and I would like to say, we have so many countries today in Europe where we have no reimbursed augmentation therapy. I'm convinced that most of the alphas in the other countries where there's no treatment, they would be happy to get in a trial or even to get treated by aerosol or by inhalation. And so the situation is very, very different in every country. And we cannot say in general it's a good one or it's a bad one. We have to look at and we have to decide. And we have to stay open to new ideas. One thing I would like to tell you is if you are on a volunteer job in a small patient association and you are an alpha and you have your to-do list, here you see my to-do list from March, and every evening or in the morning I write down the hours I spent on different activities. And I'm not paid for this. I'm doing a volunteer job, but I think it makes sense to have an idea at the end of the month how many time of my life and energy I spent in my work I'm going for. Though the first one, be your butt, it's my profession. Because my profession, I'm distributor of natural paint. And then alpha is everything which is the steering committee and alpha work in Belgium. And Radiorg, the third one. I'm also in the Rare Disease Association of Belgium on the National Rare Disease Association. And, well, for me, it took less of time. But also to know, if I go for 40 hours a week or for 70 hours a week, or sometimes there might be a week where I don't do anything for these activities. Most of the time, at the end of the month, I realize that I spent more time for these activities than I thought. And so it's a question of energy and how to manage it. And perhaps sometimes to say no, or even a lot of times I have to say no, to protect myself, because I think what I'm doing here is a kind of responsibility which I share, and I have to care about myself, and I have to take my responsibility that things go the best way. And I feel that in every moment, and I'm aware of that. And so the message is, alphas, care about yourself. And if you are in the patient association, watch out. Get your priorities, don't work so hard, and sometimes take some time off for Swiss chocolate, for example. So get your key point message, like for example, in Greece it could be important in the next weeks to get the message out, what to do. And then, of course, we have a media support, which is necessary, like Facebook or a website. And then to look for some money is important. And if you have some questions, please contact me. We help you, of course. We are there to do that. And so get interconnected by networking, which doesn't mean you have to do more, but perhaps in a different way, or to do less. Thank you very much.
We are now going to present to you three physicians that have taken the lead in establishing Alpha 1 patient organizations in their countries. And we must say that we very much are thrilled for their leading the way for the physician-patient collaboration.
Hello. My name is Alessandra Dudvarsky-Ilic. I'm professor of internal medicine at the University of Belgrade, Serbia. I'm very happy to be the part of Alpha 1 community since my master thesis was the importance of Alpha 1 phenotyping in asthma and COPD patients, and it was 25 years ago, very long ago. At that time, not so many doctors in Serbia were familiar with Alpha 1 antitrypsin. In that 25 years, I have organized several medical educations for pulmonologists with the participation of pediatricians, neurologists, vascular surgeons, etc. I supported and helped organizing laboratory for Alpha 1 antitrypsin, and currently all the doctors from Serbia are referring their patients with suspected Alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency to the clinical center of Serbia where I work. At the end of 2016, we organized association for patients with Alpha 1 antitrypsin, and we are trying hard to implement international standards regarding treatment for those patients. A few months ago, Professor Horstovska contacted me about one patient from Serbia, and that was the beginning of our collaboration. After that, I got connected with Mrs. Ghani and Alpha 1 Global, and now I'm attending the first Alpha 1 Global Congress. I would be very happy if we can work together in the region in some projects. I wish you all everything the best.
Hello, everyone. A warm welcome from Warsaw. My name is Joanna Horostowska-Wynimko. I'm a professor of respiratory medicine based in Poland, very much involved in Alpha 1 activities here in my country, but also in central and eastern region of Europe. I am head of the reference Alpha Lab for Poland and other Central Eastern European countries. I am responsible for the national registry, and I actually do care for a number of Alpha 1 patients in Warsaw and in Poland. I am happy to say that Alpha 1 activities in Poland increase and evolve very nicely. We have the targeted screening free program running for all Polish respiratory patients. So the new alphas are being detected on the constant basis. I'm also very happy to say that we, several years ago, we have established a very tight collaboration with pediatricians who care for Alpha 1 kids. So now Polish patients have the best possible healthcare starting from childhood throughout the years to the adulthood, but also, and I'm very happy to say this because I promised you in Varga that we are going to have the patients organization in Poland, which has been established. And Mr. Robert Durlik, the president of the Polish patients community, is with you in Lisbon. I must say that I would love to be with you. I hope to be with you. But other activities involving Alpha 1 community actually kept me away. My center, my hospital, has become a part of a European reference center, expert center for rare respiratory disorders, ERN Lung. So we are starting this network at the moment, and I hope it will also be an important event for patients, as we actually hope to increase the effectiveness and the expertise of medical centers caring for you, for our patients. We also do our best in Central Eastern Europe. The Alpha 1 network of Central Eastern Medical Center is active, is working. We meet every other year in Warsaw to share our experience, to learn more about Alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency. So I would say both on national level and regional level, we are very active. I'm also proud to say that I am active on the global level. I was part of the investigator and physician forum in Dublin last week. I had an honor to represent Alpha-1 community in European Parliament in Brussels as a part of EU recommendation expert group. So, though I'm not with you in Lisbon, my heart is with you. And my message to you is just enjoy yourself and be active on both national, regional, and global level, because there's a lot to be done. But we are strong, enjoy being together, and we enjoy working together. So I think the bright future is ahead of us. Warm greetings from Warsaw, and just enjoy Lisbon. Bye.
And with us in person from Romania, please welcome Ruxandra.
Thank you, Karen. Good morning, dear friends. It's a great honor for us, patients and doctors from Romania, to be here. And I want to say a huge thank you for this. Thank you, dear Goni. Thank you, Frank. Thank you, Karen. You are a unique woman in the world, I think. Thank you for this huge lesson of humanity, of friendship, of how to connect people all over the world. So I want, with your permission, to present myself. I'm the president of my Society of Pulmonology, Romanian Society of Pulmonology. And with your permission, I want to present two wonderful ladies, representatives of the patients in Romania. That is Simona Olteanu. And Iulia Oiță. Thank you both. So, together, we want to discuss about Alpha-1 deficiency in Romania. Where are we, and of course, where we need to be. Of course, rare diseases represent a challenging activity for all physicians, but Alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency is one of the most challenging activities for Romanian chest physicians. Alpha-1 deficiency is slowly investigated. In other countries, still represents an iceberg. Probably around 5% of the patients are diagnosed. What about Romania? Before 2012, it was a frozen lake. It was a frozen diagnosis. We just know that it exists. Why? Because before 2012, the disease was usually identified only by plasmatic values. Starting with 2012, we start to introduce the standards of the best medical practice of Alpha-1 patients in Romania, with Leonardo European Project. It was a complex and extremely helpful activity for Romanian team with trainings in Warsaw, Hanover, Vilnius, and Leiden. But still in Romania, of course, we have no reimbursement for the medication by the health insurance system. More, till now we have some signals from Behring company. We did not have any company who is possible to bring augmentation therapy in Romania. But still in Romania, even genetic testing is possible only in the private practice and with a huge cost fully covered by the patient. But genetic screening for Alpha-1 in Romania goes on, although the European project Leonardo came to an end, with the big support of this nice lady, Joanna Korostowska, and with the national the help of the National Institute of Lung Diseases from Warsaw, free of any cost. Certainly in Romania, Alpha-1 deficiency is an underdiagnosed pathology first in the patients with COPD, which are our preliminary results. As I already said, testing is performing in Warsaw at the National Institute of Lung Diseases, and we screened till now around 700 patients. Alpha-1 suspicion is higher among men. The main reason for testing is COPD, emphysema, bronchiectasis, followed by asthma and siblings. 7.5% of screened patients were identified to have genetic modifications, heterozygous and more rarely homozygous. If we are looking at age distribution, around 50 years is the average age for testing, in accordance with a decade when commonly Alpha-1 deficiency is symptomatic and diagnosed. Rare genotypes, around 19% of the detected mutation, it may be a future for this zone of Europe. Reason for testing of modified genotype, on the first place, COPD. So COPD remains the main indication for testing at patients with modified genotype, followed by screening of first degree relatives, bronchiectasis, difficult to treat asthma, or overlap COPD asthma. Until now, 4.3% of the patients with COPD in Romania are carriers of a modified gene. What about characteristic of group with modified genome? If we are looking at AFIV1, the median value is around 60%, with a large variation between 20 to 122%. Fortunately, from the identified homozygotes, two are children, and here you have the mothers of these two nice boys, and their lung functions is still in the normal range. What else have we done for Alpha-1 deficiency in Romania? We founded the working group for Alpha-1 deficiency of Romanian Society of Pneumology. We kept increasing the Alpha-1 awareness into Romanian medical community. We have the guideline of the diagnosis and management of Alpha-1 deficiency, the version in Romanian language. We create the idea of rare lung diseases in Romania. The first conference in 2015, and Joanna Korostowska was guest of honor at this conference, and we have here the first overview of the preliminary data of alpha screening in Romania, with over 400 participants, experts from 9 medical specialties, and an exceptional involvement of young specialists, residents, and students. Also, we accessed the European Alpha organizations. In fact, Romania is one of the founding members of what Joanna said before, Alpha-1 Network of Central Eastern Europe. Here we have the presence of Romanian team at the first conference of this network, and at the second Central Eastern European Alpha-1 Network conference in 2015, with, again, the presence of Romanian team. We have published in relevant publications like European Respiratory Journal, ATS Journal or Journal of Romanian Society of Pneumology. And since 2015, Romania was represented at Alpha One Congress. Thank you for this, again, Goni, again, Frank, for inviting us. This is Romanian page of Global Alpha One website, and this is the first flyer with information regarding alpha deficiency for Romanian patients. And I have to mention the special activity of Simona in this regard, because she is the author of these informative materials for patients. But she's more than that. She's a lovely lady, a powerful and a unique mother, and a wonderful partner regarding this collaboration, this network in patient-physician team. The official Romanian website of Alpha 1 deficiency was founded in 2016, and also we start to complete the data of National Register of Alpha 1 deficiency, also in 2016 founded with the support of the Romanian Society of Pulmonology, and with a huge activity of this young and nice lady, Anna Zaharia, an exceptional young pneumologist, the coordinator of this testing for Alpha 1 in Romania. Some aspects of the National Register of Alpha 1 deficiency. Each patient has a unique code, date of birth, sex, age, county, the menu for the first data, the reason for testing, other member tested, spirometry, phenotype, plasma value, first, last, and current evaluation, successive assessments of spirometry or plethysmography, and other important clinical data as arterial blood gazes, 6-minute walking test, etc. And as novelty, we have at the last National Congress of Romanian Society of Pneumology in October last year, interactive sessions with patient associations. And Frank was guest of honor of our Congress, and this interactive session was entitled Patients' Priorities, Alpha 1 Global, a Model to be Followed. And Frank talked about Alpha 1 access and care with challenges and opportunities. And this other second wonderful lady, Iulia Oiță, taught about Alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency in Romania between expectation and reality. Indeed, you, Alpha 1, it represents a model to be followed, and I hope that this model will be essential for alpha patients in Romania. I must say that there is a significant problem still in Romania. It does not exist any association for patients with lung diseases due to excessive bureaucracy, fear of the authorities, and the feeling of hopelessness. Because usually these patients with chronic lung diseases are older than 50 years and lived a long time under communism. And into the communism, these mentalities were dominant. But Romanian Society of Pneumology attended now in February for the first time the International Conference of the Patients with Rare Diseases, organized, and thank you for this tip, dear Frank, by the Romanian Patients Alliance for Rare Diseases. And I think it is hopeful because our society discussed at this international conference for the first time the huge problems of rare lung diseases in Romania, especially regarding Alpha 1 deficiency and IPF. And also, this Patient Alliance for Rare Diseases accepted the invitation to be partner of our conference, the second national conference of rare lung diseases. So summarizing, more than 700 patients screened, mostly heterozygous for this zone of Europe. Rare genotypes are present, mostly COPD patients. Of course, screening for alphas in Romania goes on, and I hope and I'm sure that we'll be like this, we'll do more with these two powerful ladies and wonderful partners in patients' physicians' team, Simona and Julia. Again, thank you for your invitation and for this opportunity to talk about the problems of alpha patients from Romania. And in the same time, we will be happy and honored if Alpha One Global will accept our invitation to be partner to the second National Romanian Conference of Rare Lung Diseases in October this year at Oradea. Best friends always stick together, so that's why we are here together again, because keeping together, again, Frank, you are right, is a progress, and working together is a success. Thank you.
I think I speak on behalf of everyone in this room. We're deeply impressed with the work. Is there any, we can have a short question and answer session with Ruxandra. So, let's open it up. Questions, and we'll get some microphones out in the room. Yes, Tim.
Thank you so much for the optimism that you have brought to this group. And I'm so impressed by the work that you have done. My question is, are you also working with Alpha-1 liver patients in Romania?
Well, we started to do this year, and for the first time, we shall be together at this national conference for lung diseases, because we want not only with liver specialists and patients of with Alpha-1, but also with pediatricians. Here is another focus for us.
Do we have any more questions, perhaps? I know there must be some more intriguing questions to be asked. Yes.
This is a question to you and to Frank as well, because you've been in such close partnership, and I think it's relevant to all of us. Many times the burden of proof is on all of us to show that it's important. On the other hand, everybody knows that their children are important and their siblings are important as well. Sometimes anecdotal information about the impact on children or grandchildren and the understanding of where you came from, your parents or grandparents, is very powerful with the politicians and with the policy makers. Can you comment, Frank, perhaps, or our guest, on how you might be approaching that, given that you haven't a lot of history like we have here, but maybe the anecdotal can be a really big, important aid to getting our message across?
If it's possible, I will answer first. One of the greatest success of our society, I think, in this year was the law against smoking. So we have now in Romania the law against smoking, which forbidden to smoke in any public place. It was, yes, it's a big success, and also a big fight, because when this law was first accepted, a group of politicians started and want to redefine the idea of the indoor place. So to change the possibility to be an option for the restaurants or public spaces to say, yes, this is only for smoking. But we fight a lot, and this is what NOS modified. So we have a very big and strong law against smoking in Romania. Regarding the siblings, again, still, because of mentalities, we fight a lot with Simona and Iulia. Still, even their siblings, it's not very easy to bring them and to test them, especially young generation. But again, we are fighting.
Thank you for the question. I would like to say something about the politicians, because, of course, they are very important. So when I came to Romania, for me it was not an unknown country, but a quite new landscape, a beautiful country, beautiful people with the own with an own culture, with an own language, and so quite difficult to adapt or to get in. So I was very aware about a lot of difficulties, and also in my toolbox, a lot of tools I couldn't use to work with. So this is quite specific for Europe, where we have 47 countries with 250 languages, and we only have 13 countries where we have reimbursement. And so political stakeholders are very important. And when we planned with our expert committee to bring out the European recommendations, which is the booklet you have in your brochure, we thought what could be the most impact also on the policy stakeholder side. And so I think, for example, in the 22nd of March, when we had the audience in the European Parliament with three members of the European Parliament, even if it one was British and another one was Finnish and the third one was from Malta, this will have an impact in a midterm way of all these countries of Europe, and it makes sense to bring this in another way down. So I would like to say we have to work on a lot of level at the same time. And it's fantastic with Rosandra and the Romanian crew to work on different levels, like with the Chronic Disease Association or COPD Association or Rare Disease Association or Tuberculosis, which is another aspect of public health, which is very important.
And Cancer Association too.
And cancer also, and to bring all these levels together at the same time. So,
thank you. Thank you very much, both for the...
Thank you.